Hello, this is Jitte Wagen, and this is the first screencast in a series of screencasts in which I will be introducing relational databases in Microsoft Access 2016. In this first screencast, I will be dealing with introducing the software. I will be showing how you can open a table, how you can manipulate data in a table, and show basic functions such as searching for data, replacing entries in database tables, sorting the data, etc. Now, before starting, I want to make two remarks. First of all, this course is about relational databases. Actually, in general, I have to choose a platform in order to show how to work with relational databases, and I've chosen Access for a couple of reasons, which are that for those of you who want to learn to work with databases, it is a database type that is easily to get by because it's part of Microsoft Office, which is of course a software suite that's still very much in use. But the most important reason is that Microsoft Access databases are still the most common in the archaeological practice. That has in itself a couple of reasons. It's available, as I said, in Microsoft Office, so many people have it. It's portable, it has a good graphical user interface, and it has a long use tradition. So these are reasons why I use Microsoft Access 2016 as a context for the explanation of how you work with relational databases. But most of the principles I will be explaining are general and also will inform you on using other database software platforms. So just to emphasize, I'm not promoting the use of Microsoft Access in any way. I'm just using it as a context for explanation. A second remark I want to make before starting off with the actual course is that I presume that you have already knowledge on database normalization and design principles. So the whole concept of a database, of course, is an efficient, creating an efficient system of dealing with data. So you can easily query it, you can easily change it, you can easily access it. It's not redundant in any way. You don't store any redundant information, etc. And there's a whole, let's say, the database theory or information management theory behind it is sometimes explained in the entity relationship approach. Sometimes the more formal way to go about it is to apply database normalization through the one to the first to the sixth normal form. But in any case, all this theoretical information on how you should deal with database design before you even start up the software is not part of this course, but will be assumed as familiar. Okay, so let's start with the actual course. I just started up Microsoft Access 2016. And this is what I get as a starting screen. So I have here in the center, I can start up a whole range of templates. And to the left, I can access recently used and opened databases. Now, if you have installed this, or if you had it already but never used before, you will not have all these recent files, and we'll just go and open the database that I use as training database for this course. So I open other files here, and then I come into this menu. I can click on browse, and I can browse to the location where I placed my training data for this course. So I will do it, open it. And now the actual main interface of Microsoft Access opens. Okay, so the interface of Microsoft Access is the typical Microsoft ribbon interface. So we have these different tabs here that each open a different ribbon filled with menu options. Then here in the center, we have our main data window in which all the tables that we will open will appear. But here, this is also the place in which we will create and manipulate forms or create and execute queries, etc. And then finally, to the left, we have here what is called a shutter bar, which displays all the contents of our database. So it's it functions as a table of contents, and any object that we can have here is a table, obviously, but also queries, forms, reports, and it allows us to sort and organize this in an easy way, so we can navigate to categories, filter by group, etc. And especially very useful if you have a database with many tables and many different queries and forms. Okay, so now let's engage with the data that we have here. And as you can see, there's one database object currently in the database, which is a table called tracts. And we can double click to see its contents. Now, this is a database designed for a survey project, so an archaeological field survey project, which happens to be in Greece. And what you can see here is a database table that shows tracts. So there is an entity in this database called tracts, which are the actual fields that have been walked and where information is gathered and archaeological finds have been collected in order to make a map of archaeology in the area. Okay, so how does this table work? This is actually a data sheet view, as it's called in Microsoft Access Database. And how does it work? We have here this table, and every individual entity has its own record. It has an ID that is unique, and this is called tracked ID. And then it has a number of attributes that have been given various columns. So the attributes of every tract are divided over various columns, and these columns are then named by based on the information in that column. So this is recorded by, so who actually made the record for this tract, what is the number of this tract, where was it, on what date was the record created or the field walk, that's of course an interesting distinction, what sample type was performed, what notes were noted down, etc, etc. Okay, so just to make sure that we get our terminology straight here, so what we have here is a table representing an entity. The entity are these tracts. Every individual tract is a record, which is also called in a database design terminology a row. One row represents one instance of that entity. Then it has an ID and a set of attributes which are divided in columns, and an intersection of a row and a column creates a field. And in that field, you will find a value. So the attribute has an actual value which is stored in that field. So with this concept, so columns, rows, records, fields, values, and entities, we have a large part of the fundamental database terminology already covered. Okay, so we can now, what we can do is we can maximize the view of this table, and you can see the difference between the various records is here again indicated by these various hues of gray. If we select a record, it will turn blue and has this this pink selection line around it. And by using the selection boxes on the left of every record, we can select them, as we can do the same thing by selecting the column headers, and then everything in that column, all the fields in that column are selected. Okay, if there are any fields that have a size that is not large enough to cover the whole content of those fields, we can simply change the size of these fields. And if we would double click on the edge here between two fields, or two columns, I should say, it will be automatically enlarged to be able to allow for displaying the complete content of those fields. Now, then there are several ways to navigate through the data. Now, this is a very small table with very few items in it. But if it would be, for example, very long, so I would have many fields with many columns with many attributes, you can see that if I simulate this by just making the fields larger, we will have a scroll bar down here. And clearly, if we would have 1,000 of records in this table, we would have a scroll bar automatically appear on the right, and so we can scroll up and down. Another way to navigate data in your table is by using the find function, that you can use to look for specific values in a column. So if I would, for example, be interested to find grab samples, I could hit right click on the header of the column, go for find, and then I could indeed enter the search term of my choice. I could hit enter, and then I would jump to the first, or in this case, next grab sample in this column. So in this way, you can simply navigate through a table by looking for specific finds. Or terms, I should say. Now, if you would want to change data in a specific field, it is a simple matter of typing in a new term. So if I would, for example, want to have this sample type changed from transect sample to grab sample, I can simply type grab here, and the data will automatically be updated. Now, note that there is no saving mechanic to manipulations, individual manipulations in the table. So once I change this, this is definite, and the only way to undo it is if I directly use the undo function. But there's no procedure, there's no mechanic of saving then working for half an hour on your data, and if you're happy, you save it again with a new version number or whatever. You can save the database as a whole. That's definitely possible. So in that sense, you can work with it in that way, but you cannot do it table by table. So this is important to understand. So if you want to undo this operation, this changing of value that I just did, I can hit Control Z, or I could have used, I shall do it again to show this. There is here in the top left, there is the classic Microsoft Office undo button, so I can also undo it in that way. Now, clearly then, if you want to delete values, you can also go about it the same way. So I can select a field value and then hit delete, and it would be deleted. And I can also undo that by hitting Control Z. And then again, I can do this with a complete record. So if I can now click on delete, and it would be deleted. The important thing to remember is that you cannot undo the deletion of a complete record. So if you do that, make sure that you are absolutely certain that this is what you want to do, or work on a copy of your table. Now, you can also change values on a global scale, which means that you change them wherever they occur in a column or table at once. Now, the way to do this is to go back to the find function that we activated earlier by right-clicking on a column. We'll go to find. And here you may have noticed that there is another tab which is called replace. Now, if we do that, we are presented with a second column here in which we can say, well, if you find term A, we want to replace it with term B. So we could say that we want to change grab into random. Now, what you can do then is say find next, and if you could then hit replace to have it replaced. The other way to go about it is to hit replace all, and then all the values will be replaced in one go. Again, important to note here is that a replace all action cannot be undone. So once you do it, it's definite until you manipulate the fields again, of course. Okay, so for the final part of this first screencast, I want to show how you can modify the representations of data. So how you can modify the sorting of columns, which columns are visible, etc., etc. And that can be very convenient, of course, again, if you have a large table, much larger than this one, and you want to see your data in an ordered fashion, or you want to exclude some pieces of data that you do not need to see for the specific question you you are trying to answer. So I will first show you how you can order the records in a table based on the field value. So let's say that I would want to sort all these records on the person that recorded them, or recorded the fields that were surveyed in these transacts. So I would do that to right click the column header, and then here I have two options: sort from A to Z, or sort from Z to A, which is of course the same as sort ascending or descending. So if I would sort from A to Z, then I would have the all these records neatly ordered, starting with A and then all the way up to Z, of course. And if I would sort from Z to A, it would do the same thing exactly the other way around. Now, in case you want to hide specific fields, or unhide for that matter, you can right click on a column and then go for the option hide or unhide fields. And if you would click on that, you would the actual column that was active at the moment you went for that option is actually being hidden. If we want to unhide fields, we can click on unhide fields, and here we can actually interactively change the columns that are being shown. And this is of course very useful if you have a column that that is necessary to have in your database but actually does not contain any data you want to see at that moment or work with. Now, another thing that can be useful is to know that you can change the location of a column. So if I would want, for example, to directly compare the dates and the people that recorded these tracts, I can left click on the column and then keep it clicked, and then drag the column, as it were, next to the column that I want to compare it with, and then the column is indeed moved in our table view. So it's important to know about this, that if you would now want to save this, that if you now close this table, these adaptations to the visualization of the data are actually saved. So if I would say close this window, which in this case would mean close the table, Access actually asks, do you want to save changes to the layout of the table tracts? And if I will say yes, and then open it again, you will see that I indeed will have my order, the Z to A sorting of my column recorded by, still in place, and I have my date column now next to recorded by. And if I would have hidden or unhidden fields, then it would also have been preserved in the as a modification to the visualization of this table. Okay, and then finally, a very powerful way to work with visualization of the data in this table are to apply selection criteria. Now this is an action that you can also, and maybe at some level, would prefer to do using queries. If you want to have a very quick selection of data based on the criterion, you can do it directly in the table view using the Microsoft Access options. Now, a way to go about this is to select, for example, to place the cursor in a field with a specific value, and then you could, for example, go into the selection box on the ribbon. And just as a side note, of course, all the options that I've been so far showing in the context menu that you make appear hitting the right mouse button is of course a short list into all the options that you can also find in the ribbon. So I use these interchangeably, and it's a bit depending on your own habits in working with these various programs. But just know that these are obviously the same functions. So if I would here click on selection now, and I would go for the first option, equals transect, you can see if I click on that immediately my record set, as you call the collection of rows in this table, is filtered on the criterion transect in the column sample type. Now, important to notice is that now the button toggle filter here has been highlighted with a gray box around it, and here below I also have a orange U now to this option over here, which says filtered, and if I would click on either of those, the filter would be undone. So now it says unfiltered. I go to selection equals transect, and you can see that it shows filtered again. So that is of course important to know, that if you look at someone else's data and he may have filtered it, that you are aware of the fact that it has been filtered and that it's you're not looking at a complete data set. Now, as you may have noticed, there are more advanced types of criteria to select for. So here you have equals, but you can also say does not equal, contains transect, or does not contain transect. And the last two, of course, refer to the situation in which the value is not exactly transect, which equals or does not equal mean, but just contains the word transect as a part as a part of a combination of words. Now, and if this would not be enough, there's also the option to right-click a field, go for text filters. Here you, by the way, can also see that these are also part of the context menu. But if you go for text filters, you have yet four other options, which are begins with, does not begin with, ends with, and does not end with. So there you have eight options of very common selection criteria that you can use directly from out of the context menus. So that can be very useful. Now, the last thing that I would like to show you is that you can combine these various selection criteria. So if I would again, for example, go for transect and then select only for transect samples, and I would then, for example, want to select all the fields which are recorded by the person with the initials AK, and I would again select equals AK, I will have a sub-selection. So you go on selecting, combining these criteria actually. You can do that as long as you want. So yeah, that can also be a very direct and useful way to make a very quick selection directly in your database table. Okay, so then the last thing to say about this is that these selections are not saved with your table. So if you would now close the table and say we want to save the design of the table tracks, and we would open it again, we would have an unfiltered table. And what's interesting is that if you want, it is possible to save your selection. I will show you how you can do that. So if you, I would go back to what we've just been setting up as a filter. So all transect samples recorded by person with the initials AK. What we can do now is we can go to file, save as, and then we can save the object. So what you then actually do is you save the object, which is now a table. And what it will do if we select this is it will ask us, how do you want to save this? Do you want to save this as a new table? Or do you want to save it as a query, for example? And this can be very useful. So let's say we want to call this query tracts. If we want to be able to reapply this, we want to maybe be able to modify the query, and we will do this in a later video in the series of videos. We can save it. Now we click OK. And if I would now go into this the shutter bar, and I would go to the group type queries, I can also just go for all objects. We can see that we can now, well, maybe show it. Let's turn them all off first. I can go to query tracts, and then I have this selection that I set up here. And we can also, and here is also a sneak peek into the video on queries, how that looks like in the query design raster, just to show that you've actually been creating using very simple table interface features an actual query with the selection criteria. Okay, so that would be how to save your selection or your filter by saving it as a query. And the important information again is that these are not automatically saved as an object or as part of your table visualization modifications. Okay, so with this, I want to finish this screencast. Well, thank you for listening and watching.